Hey there, what's going on? I'm Darieth Chisolm. Welcome to this edition of Hustle and Heart TV. You know, I really consider myself fortunate in that I've had the wonderful opportunity to share in conversation with you powerful stories of people who are really moving and shaking in this world. And this next interview with singer, songwriter, and producer Marsha Ambrosius is definitely one of those. We sat down in a private suite at the Westin Hotel as she got ready to do this incredible performance at the August Wilson Center. And she opens up about her challenges as a singer and a songwriter in the very busy music industry. She tells me about her conversations and relationships with Michael Jackson, Alicia Keys, Kanye West, and so many more. And she's got some incredible information to help spur you on to the next step in your life. So sit back, relax, and take in this great conversation with Marsha Ambrosius on Hustle and Heart TV. Like so many entrepreneurs, I'm drawn to the glamorous, gorgeous, larger-than-life, iconic ideas and outcomes that represent success. I'm amazed at just what it takes to truly be a standout, a rock star, a millionaire, a trendsetter. It ain't easy, but somebody's got to do it. So why not you? I know it takes hard work and hustle to make things happen, but I also believe it's a matter of heart. We can manifest our greatest desires with a little less sweat equity and a little more divine guidance, plus be equally inspired by someone else's life story. I'm Darieth Chisolm. I'm here to help you unleash, unlock, and bloom your dreams in business and in life. I'm a speaker, author, entrepreneur, life and business coach, media personality, and video podcast host. Every week, my team and I uncover dynamic, authentic, heartfelt conversations to help you leverage tools and resources, make more money, live the lifestyle of your dreams, become a rock star, and love your journey. So excited about sitting here next to the lovely and talented singer and songwriter Marsha Ambrosius. Thank you so much for being on Hustle and Heart TV.
Thank you for having me. I'm so excited to be here.
Oh, thank you very much. Marsha, I've got so many questions I want to ask you, but I think the thing that is most compelling for me right now is to just ask you, how is it that you come up with your lyrics and your music? I mean, you are just so deep.
Yeah, that's one way of putting it. I'm a shallow, though. Shallow but deep. Introverted extrovert. I've always managed to capture honest moments in music. And I guess that what makes it deep, but what makes it simplistic in its deepness is I say things that you wouldn't otherwise say in a song. It's more so a conversation rather than me concentrating on it rhyming or being structured or the foundation being a blueprint of, you know, a formula. Some music is very formulaic. For me, feelings, there's no formula to that. There's no formula to true love or true heartbreak or true joy or true pain doesn't rhyme. So for me, the music that captures your heart the most is when I'm writing freely and writing from an honest place that anyone can connect to, whether you've lost someone, loved someone, broken up with someone, or you wanted to kill someone because they cheated on you. Those are all parts of life. And you tend to just grasp those moments, and I make music from that place.
Yeah, it's a very transparent, organic, and raw expression mm-hmm. of emotion, as you say.
Yeah.
And what I find so fascinating is obviously you're able to bring in the musical elements, but as we talk about the words, so in those conversations that you're having with us mm-hmm. around those true, honest things, do you sense that you're talking to yourself, or are you literally talking to a girlfriend or someone?
It depends on the song. Sometimes I've listened to songs that I've created 10 years prior and realized in that moment I was talking to me, when in the moment I'd never been through that experience ever. I was definitely externalizing someone else's true story so I could speak about it, but there was no empathy there until growing up 10 years later, having listened to it. And I should have taken my advice then. I was like, I was speaking to my own heart then, not knowing. So I vary in that way. But I think for the most part, I must be speaking to me.
Is it brave for songwriters, for singers, for producers, anyone in the music industry to really step out that bravely with their music? Or do you sense that people tend to hold back and then they can't connect with their audience because they're holding back?
It's the Jerry Maguire moment. It's the who wrote that memo? And once you do, it's let me put myself out there. Mm-hmm. And who's coming with me? I've literally poured my heart out and I've dug deeper and almost drowned. And I've let people watch that. And I think they're the moments that people truly appreciate. And they're the ones that never go away. When you've actually openly broken your own heart or openly admitted fault or flaw or the true essence of giving your heart away to someone else. So through the music, through the melody, through the production of it all, the bravery truly is just stepping out. It's Jerry Maguire. Yeah. Who's coming with me?
You know, it's therapeutic in many ways. I mean, you know, this show, Hustle and Heart TV, we really explore the hustle and the heart of a successful person and what it takes to work hard and climb and become what it is that you dream about. But along the way, we do face challenges. We do
Absolutely.
Have stuff that gets in the way. And, you know, we want to back down and we want to pull the covers back over our heads and not get out of bed on days. And As a writer, as a songwriter, being able to flush that out through words and then, of course, sing it is some level of, I would think, therapy.
Oh, it's free therapy.
Yeah.
Free. Absolutely.
For you
free.
And for the listener.
Right. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. So what would you encourage someone who is, you know, in this place of maybe trying to get past a fear or get past something that's challenging them and their ways that they might find therapy or move forward?
They'd have to be honest with themselves. You can never force that moment for someone else. Some people aren't ready. And there are ways of getting around that. As I said, songs that I'd written 10 years prior, you do externalize. You do lend from other people's experiences. So I'd say for anyone who was in that place, whether it's happy, sad, mad, whatever it is, don't be afraid of that. Don't run from that moment because that's the part that captures you the most. That's the part that people connect to the most. And I've written songs where I disagreed with myself, but the outcome was always optimistic. So I still left it open-ended just so I could then possibly have a part two or knew there was a continuation of things. And that's what makes for albums on albums on albums rather than, okay, let me put out a single and see where that goes. Mm-hmm. There's more to the story. I think there's more to music and more to the human heart that people give themselves credit for. Love, the word, is loaded in itself. So there are so many ways you can write about that. I just don't see the need to reserve that. So when someone's ready to step out, you don't have to completely fall off a cliff, but take a parachute.
Yeah, I like that. Take a parachute. That's one of those. I'm going to remember that along the way. Take a few of them sometimes, right?
Several. Yeah. The backup and,
and
someone
backup
else is a tandem, whatever you need.
Yeah, whatever you need to make that happen. But I can't hate you. Are you interested in learning more about podcasting and video podcasting and how you can build your brand, influence, and income through podcasting? I'd be happy to help. In fact, you can schedule a complimentary discovery session with me. Really simple. Just go to podcastingandyou.com. Leave me your name and your email. You might want to check out one of my upcoming trainings as well. Or simply send me an email at info@darieth.chisolm.com and we'll get some time scheduled to discover how podcasting can help you grow your business and your brand.
Do you dread going to work every day? Stuck in a dead-end job? Hi, I'm Daryl Warden of the Miles Group. I love my career and you can too. We're looking for people who like to go to work, have a great time, take control of their schedules and take charge of their lives.
I worked in food service and I never knew that I could be happy, help people, and make great money.
We will train you, help you get your license. If you want to work amongst friends and make great money, call Team Warden at the Miles Group.
Welcome to the Pittsburgh Marriott City Center, where all of your meeting, events, and travel needs can be met.
I'm Dana Luco, and I handle the sports, military, education, religious, and fraternal markets here at the Pittsburgh Marriott City Center. From professional football teams to national church conferences, our hotel makes a perfect fit for you. The majority of our meeting space is located on one floor, so you'll be less likely to lose attendees, and as a planner, you know how important this is. Our over-the-top service and can-do attitudes of each employee will provide you the smoothest event possible. So contact me, Dana Luco, and tell me all about your needs.
Check us out online on Facebook at Pittsburgh Marriott City Center or call today at 412-471-4000 to make your next event brilliant.
Hello, I'm Dr. Vonda Wright. I'm an orthopedic surgeon and the medical director of the UPMC Lemieux Sports Complex, and you're watching Hustle and Heart TV with Darieth Chisolm.
So when you're writing for someone else, I mean, you've collaborated with some amazing artists. I mean, when you think about whether it's Alicia Keys or Kanye West or, you know, those Charlie Wilson, the great Michael Jackson, I mean, all of these opportunities that you've had to either write, produce, or collaborate. What is it about that now you know that piece of your music is now living in them?
Oh, it's overwhelming to hear the question even being asked. I've truly put in the work myself, but the names that you did mention, whether it's Kanye, Alicia, Charlie Wilson, Michael, these are artists in their own right that have their own stories, have their own heartbreak, have their own joy, and have fans that have grown with them and watched their story and connect with their music differently than you would an average artist. So it's almost like we were lending off of each other. So I don't feel like, even though I'm no Michael Jackson, I'm no Charlie Wilson, no Kanye, no Alicia, what I brought to them was the ability to be as free as they were, you know? So it's almost like, whether it's the cool kids, whether it's the geeks, the jocks, we get to sit at the same table. Like art, there's a place for it all. And I just fit in somewhere because I'm able to be honest and people are able to create how they feel through me. And that's what you get to do as a writer. I can walk into the room with Alicia. And at the time, she was pregnant with Egypt the last time we worked. And she hadn't told anyone. But, you know, female synergy, I kind of knew. And I'm like, oh, love, that's where you are. And we walked into the studio and were able to write from an honest place in that way. When I was with Kanye, he sat me down and said, so it's weird that you have that song, Hope She Cheats on You with a Basketball Player, and I'm with Kim. And we had a joke about that line that I have in the song. Then we created. So there are personal moments and all of these musical moments where we connect the dots and create. It's just all about creativity. And I'm just fortunate to have role played from yay high to now. Imagined myself in the position to tell Michael Jackson what to do, never knowing it was going to happen. But I'm like, yeah, one day I'm going to be Quincy Jones. And that day I had to be.
You know, and I'm sitting here thinking to myself, like, when you were a young girl growing up in Liverpool, England, I mean, to think that you'd grow up and you'd be telling Michael Jackson what to do.
It's like, so stupid.
It's so
even
cool.
To say, yeah, it is the coolest thing, but to say out loud, if I couldn't press play and know it for real or see tweets go by like, oh, I didn't know Marsha Ambrosius wrote or whatever song, I can press play and see these things are real for me. For me, they're just moments that I have to deal with. I had to, like I said, just become Quincy Jones in the moment with Mike and a mixing desk, and I'm telling him what to do in one corner. I'm looking at the engineer like, can you just delete that? All right, take it back. One more time, Michael. And all of these things are running through my head. I had to become who I wanted to be. And I feel like for every writer or performer or producer, acknowledge truly what it is that you want to do. Like for me, I always wanted to create. I didn't want to be famous though. that was something that scared me, because I'd seen what fame had done to people that I cared about. And that wasn't for me. I just wanted to be the cool kid that didn't need the laminin, the VIP pass. I could get in the club without being on the list. I wanted to be that ghost that just came in and out and did something crazy that people went, wow! And then I could just go to Target or Kmart or Walmart, Red Lobster, be as regular as regular comes.
You want to do the really great stuff, but then not necessarily have to deal with the stuff that goes around.
The circus, because
yeah,
there is
circus
a circus.
Around it, yeah.
And I love it. I get invited every now and again. I have to be there, sometimes to spectate, sometimes to absolutely juggle or climb on an elephant. And that's cool too, but I know when to throw in the towel. Mm. I know when to go home. Mm. Some people don't want to go home. Mm. And I feel like writers need to really be sure and clear what it is they want to do.
Yeah, you know, you mentioned two things, and one is that really being really clear about who you want to become.
Mm-hmm.
Because without that, it's really hard to kind of travel whatever direction you're moving.
Oh, yeah.
And being
oh, yeah.
clear about that, but then also knowing when you need to not be that person so you can,
yeah.
as you say, walk away from the circus.
But that's the thing. There's no turning back. Once you've decided, you know, I want to be the greatest in the world, there's a price that comes with that. And I say price because it's a price. There's a price tag on your forehead for wanting to be that. I just say I want to be a great producer and a great songwriter. I can be that from afar and give the work. But I've put myself in a position where I'm not only the songwriter and the producer, I am the artist. So there's this demand, great or small, for me to do a little more than it's expected of me. And I needed that push from people who believed that before I believed it. Like, I would have been comfortable being behind the scenes for forever, but the music that I did manage to create and forcibly put out to the world did something. It did change things. It was Grammy nominated and Grammy winning. It was Soul Train Awards winning, BET Award winning, just all of these things that came with me just deciding to jump off that cliff, no parachute,
jump
no
fly.
Tandem, no nothing. I'm like, this was a bad idea, but it feels amazing. I don't know whether or not I'm going to hit the ground or I'm going to realize that I can fly. Mm. It's crazy.
Love it, love it, love it, love it. What is for you the best piece of music that you've created and why?
Whew.
Okay, your couple best pieces.
Couple best pieces. Memorable, definitely Butterflies would be one of them. Because that wasn't something I was intentionally making for Michael. That's why I say Butterflies. It is a fantastic song, but it was a song I wrote about a boy I had a crush on that worked at McDonald's in Camberwell. He used to sweep the floor, and my house was 5 minutes away from my home, but my friends used to live kind of far away from school, so they would get the bus, so I'd walk 10 minutes to get to McDonald's on the bus stop just to stand outside to look at him. Because I had this crush and there were these butterflies, and I wrote this song when I was like 16, 17. And a couple years later, it turns out to be the demo that would get played to Michael Jackson's personal manager. And that's crazy. Because mm-hmm. that timeline for me didn't feel like any time at all. I remember my school uniform. I remember writing the song. Then I remember getting a free flight to Atlanta, then to Philadelphia, then getting in the studio with A Touch of Jazz and Jazzy Jeff's producers at the time. And there's Andre Harris, who's done Jill Scott's The Way and Long Walk and songs that I loved. And I was like, there's something about you. I have this song called Butterflies and blah, 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 play the keys and he adds the drums. And it's Michael Jackson's song. That's insane.
That's divine.
I'm missing parts out, but truly, in a nutshell, that's insane to me. It's one of the most insane musical moments I've ever had.
Wow, wow. What would you say, just the flip of that, because that is so awesome, mm-hmm. is perhaps been the biggest challenge for you in your career?
Dealing with real life and having to carry on, whether that's my grandmother or my aunt passing away, whether it's my nephew getting sick and at the time I was in California, he's in London, and just bad phone service, not being able to get anyone on the phone, and the panic that it was that part trips me out, because no one else, not saying no one else cares, but it doesn't matter to someone else as much as it matters to me. So it's, hey, Marsh, you've got to present this BET award now. I'm like, my nephew's sick. In 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
The show goes on. Yeah.
At all times. Mm-hmm. And it's harsh reality. The harshest reality being that I faced in the industry. One of them was definitely when Whitney Houston passed away. And I was in that hotel. I was at the Beverly Hilton the night before, because we were doing Clive's party. We were rehearsing the night before. Everyone was there, myself, Brandy, Alicia Keys, too many people to name. But the night of the show, I remember getting dressed for the show and leaving the restroom, getting in the room, and everyone was just crying. In a split second, I just said, I'll be right back. Got in the shower, got out, and everyone is in tears. And it was on CNN, Whitney Houston dead. And it was just final, not no lead up. I guess with Michael's passing away, it was the whole, he's had a heart attack, he's not dead yet. There was this circus around it. With Whitney, it was final. And I was there three floors above her. So I'm looking at the news and I'm like, she's downstairs. I just saw her yesterday. No, this is not happening. I leave the room. The hallways are packed with people running frantically. We were signed to the same label at the time. So I saw my label rep and I saw her cry. So we just break down in the hallway. And I remember consoling Brandy. And I remember people downstairs in the lobby were waiting for the red carpet and interviews. And I remember a woman with a microphone, so hyped to get a soundbite of how I felt about Whitney passing. I think I blacked out on her and cursed her out at the time. Very quickly though, on some F no, I will not answer that question right now. And she checked herself like, that was absolutely inappropriate. That wasn't the time for this. And I was like, no one ever gives common courtesy for it ever to be a time for this, because it's Whitney. But when it was my grandmother or my aunt or my nephew that was sick, there was no news. And I had to really check myself with that. That mattered to me in that moment. It mattered to the world. And we still went to that Clive party. We still sat there in tears. Everyone from Joni Mitchell to Diana Ross. I honored Diana Ross that night and sang for her. Something I'd always wanted to do. Solemnly so, I'm singing the saddest Diana Ross song ever, and not a dry eye in the house, for different purposes. Mm. So it was just harsh.
Are you looking for a way to advertise your business, product, or service? Why not do it here on Hustle and Heart TV? We'd be happy to send you our media kit for show sponsorship and advertising. Reach out to us at info@darieth.chisolm.com or give us a call at 412-692-1600 and we'll send you a media kit with all the information.
CTC Booking Travel and Entertainment Cruise Productions, the world's leader in full-ship charter music cruises, announces 5 cruises featuring the best in jazz music entertainment. The Signature Cruise, Smooth Jazz Cruise, The Jazz Cruise, 80s Cruise, and Gospel Music Cruise. Sail for 7 days with the finest music and entertainment artists in the world. Go to jazzcruisecatalog.com and book your cruise today. When it comes to food, family, and tradition, Atria's is your dining destination. Atria's has a passion for food, and it all starts with our culinary trained chefs. From the made-from-scratch rubs and dressings to the best in the burr crab cakes, Atria's prides itself in serving honest and real food. Come and see what makes us different at one of our 8 locations. We're now offering private dining, to-go, and full-service catering. Atria's. We're always changing courses.
Hello, I'm Edgar Snyder of Edgar Snyder & Associates. You've been seeing me on television for the last 30 years saying, and remember, there's no fee unless we get money for you. And I'll see you on the next episode of Hustle and Heart TV with Darieth Chisolm.
You've lived a very serendipitous life. I mean, it's really this crossing and this fabric, this weaving of great emotion and great success and some sadness, and the opportunity to literally be involved in some of the most amazing singers and songwriters in the world has seen. I mean, and you have to pinch yourself sometimes.
Every day, it's like, what did I do to get here? And not a lot of people ask the right questions. You know, this has been the nicest interview that I've had in a while, where it's freeing, because I do get to tell. I've never told these stories before because it doesn't come up. People don't think about that part anymore. So I'm glad that, you know, you have this show to really showcase what that means for people like me. Solemn, sad, but a lot of heart had gone into me being able to sit here and say I lit the Christmas tree with the president. That was crazy. I don't know how I got in there. I just remember that we had to show our passports. They did a background check, and they said I was okay to go in the White House. That's crazy. That was crazy. I remember getting the paperwork, like, we have to sign this to, wow. Okay, what am I singing? Winter Wonderland? Okay. This is weird. And I remember standing on stage, and it's the president and myself, and, you know, we're just rocking back and forth. Santa's there. Kermit the Frog was there. I was like, I'm with Barack Obama, the first family, and Kermit the Frog and Santa Claus right now. Like, how did this happen to me?
Yeah.
But I knew how it happened to me. Like I said, I wanted the backstage pass. That's it. Mm-hmm. I wanted to do something great enough. And I wanted to, you know, tell cool stories to my friends about it. And that was one of those cool stories.
You get to tell a lot of cool stories. Clearly, this beautiful past of yours. When you think about young people who are coming up in the industry, who dream of writing music and singing and performing, and who, for them, they are in the hustle. They're in the process of wanting to live their dream. What pieces of advice would you give to them?
The hustle is greater now than it was because of the advancement in technology. You can be your own business now. Whereas you could before, I just didn't have Twitter, I didn't have Instagram, I didn't have YouTube, Facebook, I didn't have all of these platforms where I can create my own bubble, I can create my own world and invite you to it. Whether that's 2 followers or 2 million followers, it's yours nonetheless. And for anyone who ever wanted to do so, you have to showcase yourself. You have to put it out there. The dance, from dance routines to if you sing, if you play, show that. Now you really can be seen, though. Yeah. And some people, I don't know, might be radio. Need to hear your voice then. Like, just something. You just have to do it. And there were just so many avenues and ways to go about that independently, whereas you couldn't do so before. It was about driving up to whatever big city with a tape cassette, I'm showing my age, with your demo and knocking on doors like, please listen to me. Now you can create fan bases that listen to you anyway, without a label, without someone telling you you should dress like this, be like this, sound like this. You can be yourself and have your fans, whatever that is.
People have been found and have blown up on YouTube, Periscope, Twitter, wherever.
Right.
Social media
so
gives people the opportunity.
Let's not forget Justin Bieber.
Yeah.
Bieber the Believer. My niece being a Believer, she is. She says the words confident. She's 2. Well, she's 3 now, but it's Justin Bieber's fault because she loves that song.
Because she loves that
and
song.
And was an absolute YouTube star. Like, I was on him before he was signed, before Usher got, you know, you see who has the 100 million. What? Who is this kid? That could be anyone. It's anyone. But you have to be talented. It doesn't happen because you're not talented. like the ones that just get, you know, followers or hits, that might be because you fell down some stairs and it was funny. It doesn't make you famous. Right. It doesn't make you talented. Right. Truly work on what it is that you do. The better you are, the better it will be.
Floetry, your days back in Floetry to where you are now, and what's evolved for you in that time in mm-hmm. terms of discovering yourself as your own artist and your own brand,
yeah.
and moving away from that and moving mm-hmm. into this. What was that like for you?
Trying, of course, as everything going absolutely haywire in such an egotistical driven industry, and me being a boisterous Leo, that if you cross me, I'm absolutely, oh, see.
Leo, yes, gotcha.
So you understand my gotcha. My plight. It's very much having to move on and conform to my circumstance. So in the moment where I'm left to be completely me, now I can just be completely me. So it was a transition, but one that was necessary. There were some growing pains that were definitely necessary, but it was freeing. I got to have absolutely no filter. There was no compromise in opinion, in if I don't wake up and do this interview, I've missed it. In a group, you can kind of say, oh, I wasn't feeling too good, and someone kind of pulled the weight. There was no one to pull that weight anymore. So having acknowledged that was the greatest challenge for me. It's like, wow, if I don't, doesn't. And that was cool.
Wow, right. It kind of reminds me, at least, of what you're saying. One of your songs that I absolutely love is Alone Together with Daily.
Mm.
Love the words in that. Love the melody. It's just a powerful song. And
Thank you.
I don't know if any of that had anything to do with Floetry and what you've experienced as you've grown and separated from that. But did you write that? I mean, some
yeah,
of the words.
Oh, myself and Daily wrote it.
Yeah, it's a great song.
Friend of mine, Kanai, who had also produced with me on my album, we did Hope She Cheats and Lose Myself together, and he had a session with this kid. I hadn't heard of Daily, even though we're both from the UK, I hadn't heard of Daily yet. So he was like, I'm in a session with Daily, and I have this very melodic piece of music. I want to see if you can come and write to it. So as soon as I heard the music kind of dictated where I was going to take it lyrically, which is what usually happens in my head in studio sessions anyway. And Daily came up with how I was writing it. So it was all the juxtapositions of things. It was the, you're the desert sand, I'll be your water. And, you know, just all the whole playful back and forth. But it was, I don't want to do this on my own. But if we were back to back and I knew you had my back, I'd be alone together because we're both in that same place. And it's still, to me, kind of selfish because it's admitting that, no, you don't really want that. But I know we both want the same thing. So Daily and I definitely got to create some magic with that song. But I guess it applies in some ways because some relationships creatively never die, especially with Floetry, like Nat being, you know, my sister of how many years. We've been friends for 20 plus, I keep forgetting the number, but I'm 38 gladly. We definitely met when we were like 11, 12 years old. So having known someone that long and having come to an industry so young, years have passed and collectively and individually done so much, I can press play on Say Yes now, and that was written almost 16 years ago, and remember it like it was yesterday. Mm. So there are songs that definitely apply, but they make now make more sense. Yeah. The music now makes more sense.
I want to wrap up with you, but before we do, I just tell us where you're going. I mean, because where you've been just blows me away. So I can't even imagine what's next for you.
Man.
What are you dreaming about? What's next for you?
What am I dreaming about? I'm absolutely dreaming of staying in love. I love film. I love TV. I love creating ideas for movies and movies and TV for the most part, but it's the music behind it. It's how Stevie Wonder did the entire soundtrack for Spike Lee's Jungle Fever. I would love to create music for film. Soundtracks, scores are my thing. Like, I could sing along to a score of music before I could tell you whose song was on what album. So yeah, that might be the next move for me. Wow. Like, I can listen to E.T., the score, and know what part of the movie it is. Willy Wonka. John Williams is one of my favorite composers. And Close Encounters of the Third Kind is why I wanted to get into movie scoring, because the premise of alien intelligence, the communication being through music. It was the melody. And I was like, that's so genius. Like, how genius is that?
So simple, but so genius. Yeah.
Just genius. Yeah. I was like, that's exactly how aliens would come. We would sing to each other and everything would be A-okay. And yeah, so I'll see what happens with that. I'm going to make some calls. I'll see what Spike Lee's doing. I don't know what Shonda Rhimes needs any songs for anything. I guess, well, I did get one of my songs run in Grey's Anatomy, mm-hmm. the finale, so I was so happy about that. So there are certain little things that are happening, even when I did, that's another one, The Best Man Holiday. I'm in it, which is just insane. I'm in a movie. I went to the premiere, I'm sitting there, Nia Long, Sanaa Lathan, Morris Chestnut, Taye Diggs. I'm like, I'm in a movie, in the saddest part of the movie at that. Just, it's insane. So yeah, I'm doing things that are leaning towards that.
Well, they're you remain dreams. Open, and it's clear that in that opening, you know, you're being blessed, and that's part of what living your life and living your dream is. And
way up.
You're not afraid to jump, and you're not afraid to fly. Afraid to fly. Yeah, definitely. Well, thank you so much for being on our show. I mean, it's just been such a delight to have you share your story and share your love of music in this industry and pour into the lives of our viewers and listeners. So we do appreciate it, and we'll continue to be raving fans.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
And thank you so much for watching this episode of Hustle and Hard TV.
The award-winning Savoy restaurant has become synonymous with fine dining, upscale ambiance, and a great destination for local and national celebrities to enjoy the night in style. The Savoy has won multiple Savor Pittsburgh Awards for its delicious menu. Our wine list was awarded Wine Spectator's 2012 Award of Excellence. And the Savoy has also won the American Institute of Architects People's Choice Award for its beautiful architecture and design. For dinner reservations and more info, log on to SavoyPGH.com.
The success in selling your home and getting the right price lies in the crux of your agent's ability to maximize your home's exposure to the largest number of qualified buyers. Each year, Dion Malish helps a family buy or sell a home every 5.5 days, so she's confident that her proven home selling strategies will sell your home. Dion and her team are not your traditional real estate agents. Unlike many agents who pound a yard sign, post to the MLS, then sit back and wait for your home to sell itself, Dion uses a proven, repeatable system to sell your home for up to 18% more in less time. Dion recently published 25 Tips for Selling a Home in Pittsburgh, which is also available on Amazon. If you're thinking of selling your home, you can get a free copy by visiting www.25tipspittsburgh.com. You can also contact her at 724-554-3514 or email her at dion@northwood.com.
Gotta go to work, but I won't.